Hey everyone, welcome to my channel. Today we're going to dive deep into how AI agents are actually being implemented in enterprise settings. Now, there's been lots of buzz around AI agents over the past year, and you'll probably see lots of videos teaching you how to build your personal AI assistants for things like sending emails, planning trips, ordering pizza, and so on. Well, I can see those kind of things can be really fun and engaging, but I do see a lack of content that really dive deep into the structure behind and especially how they operate in real-world business applications. Because I still get questions from friends asking like, how are AI agents actually being used in production? Like, what do these systems look like behind the scenes? So I've decided to make this video to share my own experience and walk you through some advanced agentic workflows that bring real value to business. Before we jump in, a little bit introduction about myself. My name is Zoe and I work as a data scientist and AI engineer in automotive industry. I specialize in building autonomous systems powered by large language models and AI agents for enterprise use cases. So, if you're ready to get some insights and go behind the scenes, let's get started. You may or may not have heard about the definition of AI agent, so you know it's a system that can plan, execute tasks, and work autonomously without human intervention. You probably also have seen some graphs like this that show the abilities of AI agent, like planning, reasoning, tool calling, and memory. But even so, you might still get confused, because it feels very abstract and you don't have an image in your head that shows like what they actually mean and how do these abilities actually come together to help business grow. So don't worry, I'm going to walk you through step by step with some real-world practical applications to help you better understand the logic behind. Now, agents have many applications, but if you really look at the most practical use cases, I would say customer support is probably at the top rank. Yeah, of course, I know that in 2025, customer support is not an exciting topic at all. We are seeing so many chatbots on website. We probably even want to avoid them as much as possible, right? But let me ask you a question. Have you ever wondered why we have these super intelligent chatbots like ChatGPT, Claude, DeepSeek, etc. that can understand us so well? But in the same time, if you open a website of your insurance company and use their chatbot, you probably don't want to spend any second with it and you just want to talk to a human, right? Because the bot is just so dumb. So why is that? Why do we have this huge gap between those two experiences? So let me explain. You can think that there are two types of chatbot. One is those super smart ones like DeepSeek that we just mentioned. These types of chatbot are great at helping us with a wide range of tasks because they were trained on massive amount of data and can use its own knowledge to answer questions. Those knowledge were embedded in the model during the training process, so you can think of them as their internal knowledge. On the other hand, the other types of chatbot are the ones you see on company websites. They typically connect to a database. Now, by database here, I don't mean the PDFs that you upload to the chat, but rather a large-scale backend system that stores the company's data, customer information, transactions, and so on. So whether you want these chatbots to retrieve information for you, or you want them to answer your questions, or execute tasks for you, they use a completely different logic than the first type of chatbot. And the key difference here is they don't directly rely on AI's internal knowledge as the answer to your question. Instead, their job is to fetch the correct data, retrieve the correct information, or execute tasks based on the data in their system. This second type is where AI agents really comes into play. So how does it work? I'll show you some examples and take you from the easiest case to more complicated ones. So in the simplest setup, you have a document and you want to retrieve the information from it. So first, in the backend, your document is split into chunks and each chunk is converted into a vector. So the whole database will be converted into a set of vectors and this is called vector store. When you ask a question, what happened in the backend is that your query is being converted into a vector too. And this vector is searching for the vector in your vector store that is most similar to itself, meaning that this chunk is most likely to be the answer to your question. And how does it find it? Well, it's pretty simple. You can just use cosine similarity to measure the distance between vectors. Of course, you can also use other matrices too. After you get this chunk, it will be passed to an LLM, and then the LLM will rephrase it a bit and then make it more like natural language, and then give the answer. So this whole process here is called retrieval-augmented generation, in short, RAG. Now, RAG is pretty easy to understand, but here comes to the key point. If you look at this whole process, you will notice that our powerful LLM is only used at the end of the diagram as a summarizer or rewriter to just beautify the answer. So if we remove this part, the rest is just a vector searching system that existed a long time ago before LLM even came out. So isn't a waste of ability that we only used a large language model to glorify the answer? I mean, it's not perfect, but there's so much we can do with it. Now, in theory, when you build a RAG application, you can adjust how much of the answer comes from the database and how much you want it to come from the LLM's internal knowledge. So there's a parameter that you can tune. But in practice, when we're building applications for enterprise, you would want the precise answer that comes only from your database and not risk letting the LLM hallucinate. So the question becomes, what we can do to make use of LLM's ability while not directly using its internal knowledge as the answer? Like, what other abilities that LLM has, which we also need here? One solution is reasoning or planning. When you have just a plain text-based database and a simple query, a naive RAG solution may work just fine. But once your use case gets more complicated, and then you might need a more advanced solution. For example, if the user inputs a question, compare the net profit margins of Amazon and Google in 2024, you might need to analyze and break down the user query first instead of directly converting the whole sentence into one embedding. So you probably want to decompose them into small steps. For example, you will need to first find both Amazon and Google's revenue and net profit in 2024, and then calculate the margin profit for each, and then send the result to LLM to give a detailed comparison. Now, if you ever played with DeepSeek R1, you will know that LLM has a very strong ability in reasoning, meaning that given your question, it can analyze it and break it down into small steps in order to answer your question. So that is exactly what we need here, right? To break down the complicated query from the user into small executable steps in order to retrieve the exact correct answer from the database. So here you can see, we not only have the LLM at the end of the graph as a summarizer, but also at the beginning as a planner to understand the query and plan the steps. So some steps can be done in parallel, like step 1 and step 2, and some in sequence. So we'll end up having something like this. This is a directed acyclic graph, in short, DAG. So if you see DAG mentioned in some videos about agent, this is what it means. Additionally, we assume here you retrieve information from the vector database, as I just explained before. But in practice, this kind of information you can get from some website like Yahoo Finance or Alpha Vintage by directly calling their API. This whole graph here just represents a typical agentic workflow. In a minute, you will be able to connect this graph to the fuzzy concept of agent in your head, whatever that might be. So let's now wrap them up. When a user asks a question, there's a LLM at the beginning, and you can see it as just one agent. This agent can plan a list of steps that is needed to answer the question. In practice, you can also have an agent as a classifier here, which classifies your question into different categories. This is used when you know that you would have different methods to handle different categories. Next, we have one agent connecting to a vector database, and one agent calling the API, and another agent doing the calculation. Now, the way how you want to configure those agents highly depends on your use case and on plans. So right now I'm just showing an example, but you can still also have like two agents retrieve information in parallel or call the API in parallel, or sometimes you always need to wait for the result of the previous agent and then everything becomes sequential. You can have many different functionalities. So it doesn't have to be a REC system. It could be a web search tool or maybe an agent sending emails. You can customize it however you want. It really depends on your use case. But one important thing is that you always want the whole system to be robust, like as robust as possible. Because sometimes it works pretty well for one type of question, but not for another question. And if the planner didn't get it right at the beginning, then the whole workflow won't make any sense, right? So before you handle any result to the user, you want to pass it to a critical agent to just check if your result makes any sense. So if not, then it will send back to the planner and then replan again. Okay, until now, I hope you already have a clear image of how agent works. So as you can see, the way agents work is highly flexible and customizable. Whether it's retrieving information, making API calls, or performing complex calculations, each agent has a role to play, and how they interact depends entirely on the needs of the system. The most important takeaway here is that a well-designed agentic system is not just about running tasks, right? So it's about planning, adapting, and ensuring robustness. So with this in mind, I hope you now have a deeper understanding of how AI agents can be implemented for enterprise and how they can work for, you know, building practical use cases. I hope this video gives you some valuable insights. If you enjoyed this breakdown, don't forget to like, subscribe, and leave a comment. This is my first video, so I will be really happy to receive some feedbacks, questions, or just thoughts. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.